Okay, so this problem deals with a pressure drop in a packed bed reactor, and we'll show how to solve it using a numerical integration program, which is polymath, but the general procedures can be used in a variety of different numerical simulators. And so here we have a gas phase reaction with an increase in the number of moles during the reaction. It occurs over 50 kilograms of catalyst in a packed bed reactor, and in part based on the given information, but part because you should always consider this with a packed bed reactor, we're going to need to worry about the pressure drop in this case, and we're given some numbers that will help us calculate what the pressure drop is. We're given information about the molecular weights of the two feed components. The reaction is irreversible, and elementary kinetics is written, and the feed is equimolar with an entering total flow rate of 1.5 moles per second. And we know that a conversion of 70% is achieved and want to determine the value of the reaction rate constant. Okay, and so in this problem, we're going to want to set up material balances, or at least one material balance. I'm actually going to solve this particular problem just for simplicity in terms of the molar flow rates. And so we will define a system of equations where DFA dW for a packed bed reactor is equal to the rate of consumption in this reaction, and the DFB dW is also equal to the rate of reaction because B is consumed at the same rate as A, and it's being consumed, so we'll use a negative sign here. Our rate is equal to K times the concentration of A to the first power times the concentration of B to the first power because we have elementary irreversible kinetics. And we want to solve for K. All right, we can furthermore write material balances for components C and D. And so I'm just going to do that here, that C and D, that C is formed at twice the rate, which means that we multiply one half by that side of the equation, and D is formed at three times the rate at which B is consumed. Okay, so those are our material balance equations. And we're going to want to solve those. And in order to do that, we're going to need to relate concentration to molar flow rates in order to solve these differential equations. All right, and if we're going to do these relationships, so we can relate the concentration to molar flow rate by this equation, where we divide the molar flow rate by the volumetric flow rate, or the inlet volumetric flow rate. But the volumetric flow rate won't remain at the inlet value for the entire reaction because we have the possibility of pressure drop, and we also have the possibility of a change in number of moles with this reaction, or we know there's going to be a change in number of moles, and so we need to factor both of those in through an ideal gas type relation, where this comes from the idea that V over the volumetric flow rate, according to the ideal gas law, would just be equal to T over T naught, FT over FT naught, and P naught over P. Right, and we are assuming isothermal operation, so we just have these two, and since the volumetric flow rate is in the denominator, these terms get flipped when we multiply through. Okay, and so we now can relate concentrations to flow rates, and so we would be essentially ready to go once we plugged in our constants for a solution. If we didn't have pressure drop, but in this case we have a packed bed reactor, so we need to worry about computing the pressure drop with the Ergun equation. And so we'll take a look at how to do that. All right, this shows you'll see different forms of the Ergun equation. This shows one form that's popular in Fogler's textbook, where this P over P naught term is often referred to as Y, and we'll use that in our equations here. And to compute the pressure drop as a function of catalyst mass, we first have to compute this function alpha. We have these ratios. Again, this goes to one in this problem, so we don't have to worry about that. These are things that we'll compute where FT is equal to FA plus FB plus FC plus FD. And FT naught, just with the naught subscripts. To compute alpha, we need to know this parameter beta, so we'll focus on that first. And this includes a number of terms that we'll look at the solution for. Okay, we're given a lot of this information directly. If we look at the problem statement, then one of the things we need is the void fraction phi, which is given in the problem statement as being 0.36. All right, so we have that parameter. We are going to need the mass velocity. So this is equal to the total mass flow rate divided by the cross-sectional area. So we're going to need to know the cross-sectional area, and we see that showing up in another place in this equation. And we'll need to know the mass flow rate. We're going to need to know the density of the fluid at the inlet conditions. We'll need to know GC. We're going to work in SI units. And so that makes GC have a convenient value of 1 in the units of kilograms, meters per Newton second squared. We'll need the particle diameter, and that's given in the problem statement as being 0.01 meters. So we have that number. We're given in the problem statement that flow in this reactor is turbulent. And if you look through the discussion of the Ergun equation, this is the term that dominates under laminar flow, and this is the term that dominates under turbulent flow. So we'll take the simpler form that uses this G. And so now we see that we really have all the various constants that we need in the beta equation, except for the cross-sectional area, the density, and the mass flow rate. And we furthermore, when we get to the alpha parameter, we're going to need the catalyst density, and that's actually provided in the problem statement also, as being 1,500 kilograms per meters cubed. Okay, so we have most of what we need. A lot of the remainder can be obtained from the ideal gas law. So for example, it will be useful to know the inlet volumetric flow rate, which we'll get from the ideal gas law. And so we can say that PV naught over RT is equal to the total flow rate, which is given in this problem. And it's, let's see, given to be a total of 1.5 moles per second. Okay, we're interested in just the inlet conditions. T naught is given to be 600 Kelvin, and P naught is given to be 20 bar. And I won't plug in all the values, but if you plug in the gas constant with appropriate units, then you get that the volumetric flow rate at the inlet is equal to 0.037 meters cubed per second. Okay, so that's one term that will be useful to us. All right, we're also going to want to know the mass flow rate. All right, so the mass flow rate, we can take the molar flow rate and convert it to the mass flow rate, just with the average molecular weight of the mixture. If we go back to the problem statement, we see that we have equal molar amounts of these two components that weigh 82 and 92 grams per mole. And so the average molecular weight then is 87 grams per mole. And I'm going to convert this to kilograms, so 0.087 kilograms per mole. And so then, therefore, the mass flow rate is 0.13 kilograms per second. All right, so we see we have this mass flow rate that we need here. This density is equal to the mass flow rate, and of course mass is conserved in a steady state operation, so it's equal to 0.13 kilograms per second. And then the volumetric flow rate we've just solved for. Okay, and so that gives us a value of about 3.5 kilograms per meters cubed. All right, and so we now have that parameter. The last parameter that we need is the cross-sectional area. And so if we go back to the problem statement, we see that the inner diameter of the reactor is 0.122 meters. So therefore, the radius is 0.061 meters. And we can determine the cross-sectional area to flow by just taking pi r squared with that radius. Okay, and you can see that this will ultimately involve plugging in a lot of values. One thing that I'll point out is that it's important for the units to work out to keep everything in SI, and the units will cancel. You can go through and plug them in and see that ultimately when you add them all into this final equation, you should get units on this side of per kilogram. And the easiest way to do that in this case is to work in all SI units. And so when doing so, as you'll see on the next screen, we convert this pressure into a pressure of Newton per meter squared, or therefore pascals, which is just multiply the pressure in bars times 10 to the fifth. Okay, so we have all of these equations. Now the only thing we need to do is go through and actually solve them with the Ergun equation that's in most cases, including this one, not possible to do analytically, and so we're going to use polymath software to do it. And so I'll let you inspect this sheet on your own by pausing and looking at it. And again, I won't promise that there are no mistakes in it, but I've tried to transcribe all of the relationships that we showed on the previous page, but using Y now for the ratio of P over P naught. And you'll see we have the various rate expressions, our material balances, the Ergun equation with alpha, calculations of alpha and beta, and it should incorporate all of these, the terms and the ways that we had on the previous sheet, and we've also defined the various constants that are involved. And I've also attempted to use units in the comments section for this. Okay, sometimes the integration, for this problem, it's not too tough, but sometimes the integration can have some problems if you don't use a stiff integrator. So I've gone ahead and opted to use a stiff numerical integrator. And this is basically ready for a solution. What I've done is I've guessed a value of k, and we'll see what conversion we achieve. And note that I have the definition for the conversion of A here, that we start with 0.75 moles per second of A. And so once we get to a given FA, then we can solve for the conversion. All right, so let's go ahead and look at the solution report here. We can all skip straight down to notice a couple of things. Okay, one is that we have a significant pressure drop here. So this value Y has gone from initially, of course, at the inlet of the reactor, no pressure drop. This shows the final value being 0.57. So your pressure has dropped almost half of its initial value in the course of going through the reactor. And we've been able to solve for that through the Ergun equation. And then our conversion here is 64% based on my initial guess. And so we just need to adjust, and we can actually write a program to do this, but it's pretty simple to just adjust and try to improve on this initial guess and resolve and check the value of x. You see we're still a little bit too low, and so we can resolve again. Okay, and then we see that this gets us most of the way there, 68%. I might say that that's close enough, but so it looks like it's probably going to be about 0.0035 for the value. Okay, it's 68.4%. So anyway, you can see that you can gradually vary the guess and look for the until you achieve the correct value of conversion. Wanted to point out one more thing here. Okay, and that's that the role of pressure drop. So we just achieved a conversion of 68.4% with this value of the K. So what would happen if we, instead of computing the pressure drop, ignored it? So what is the actual effect of the pressure drop in this case? Okay, so we're going to get rid of that differential equation, and we're just going to set y equal to 1. All right, so we're going to assume that there's no pressure drop in the reactor and see what kind of solution we get. Okay, and before, whereas we got a conversion of 68.4%, now you see we get a conversion of 74%. So it makes a quantitative difference, but not a huge difference in this case, whether or not you include pressure drop. If you have a larger pressure drop, then it can make a big difference in your final result.